This is Angela Valenti-Romeo. This is Colliding Worlds. Today we're at Artbeat on Main Street. We're in Vista, California. We're going to meet three of the artists involved with this gallery. We're going to learn about their work and their common denominator, which is school, Laguna College of Art and Design. Come along with us and we'll take you on another little journey. Welcome to Colliding Worlds. I'm your host, Angela Valenti-Romeo. Come with us as we take you on another journey.
My name is Alexsandra Babic, and my nickname is Sasha, and I do sign my work because it's a personal nickname, and my work is personal, very intimate, emotional, and I'm a fine artist, and I just completed my master's at Laguna College of Art and Design last year.
That's the common denominator. Thank you for being with us.
And my name is Kait Matthews, and I'm one of the co-founders of Artbeat on Main Street. And I graduated from Laguna College of Art and Design, let's see, I guess 4 years ago, 3 years ago, and I got my Bachelor's of Fine Art in Drawing and Painting. And I'm still drawing and still painting and experimenting and also trying to run a gallery at the same time.
Very easy. My name's Karen Weichart, and I'm also an alum from the Laguna College of Art and Design. I consider myself an oil painter, and I'm trying to paint personalities of animals, still lifes, dresses, whatever. Trying to show that what's special to me about the things I paint is that they have a unique personality.
One of the things that's very common with all of your work is a real sense of realism, but very different with what you do, It's like you see it, but it's just so remarkably different. And I'm wondering if that's got a lot to do with the background, the educational training that you had, because the college is known for more of a classical realism, figurative type of training. And you hark back to a time that seems to have gone by as far as contemporary painting.
I think as far as the school goes, that we all basically receive the same classical foundation, information and knowledge, but we all have different focuses, and I think that that focus reflects on our work. We focus on the form, we study the figure, but a lot of your own personality comes out in your work. My background is European, so I think that flavor shows in my work.
It's very much a feel of the old master.
It's a feel of old masters, and we have studied it. It is part of my history because I've looked at it for my whole entire life. I've traveled all my life, and so I think that shows in my work also. I try to focus on nature, on the organic form rather than the human form, because it's what has always fascinated me. It's actually a space in between the form and what you don't see.
Art is a funny thing. It doesn't matter what language you speak, and it doesn't matter how old you are. It doesn't really care. It's just that it hits you, and either it jumps out and speaks to you, and it takes you to different places. In your work, it has that same sense of realism, but it's remarkably different. It's like you want to go up and hug.
Yeah, it's funny. Creatures. Thank you for saying that. I've given my paintings names of humans, like the party dress series. I named them all after girls. I would look at the dress and say, "Who does this remind me of? This reminds me of a Cindy or whatever." And then it made me feel like I was more connected to the piece, and I'm hoping the viewers more connected to the piece. I did the same thing with these animals. I've done a series on farm animals, which might be funny, but I really love the farm animals. And when I got to close to the fence and touching them and looking at them, they're really curious and they connected with me. And I also give them human names. So it's funny. I have a hog named Walter and a cow named Violet, because that's what they seem to me. And I'm hoping that my connecting with the images on the canvas and giving them human names is helping the viewer also connect.
Having a name does help you connect. My husband has a bowling ball named Earl. Right. It may or may not help him bowl better, but Earl. It's yeah. Earl, and we take Earl everywhere. But you've humanized them.
Because I really feel like they had a personality, and I'm trying to, and the dresses have personalities. I mean, who would wear a dress that looks like this? you know, not everybody, so it's a unique thing. I also had a lot of fun with the party dress series because I purchased vintage wallpaper, like by the roll on eBay. And I would match, like, which dress, you know, who would look good with this wallpaper? Kind of got to do a little, I don't know, sort of decorating thing at the same time. It was really fun, really fun. And all the dresses aren't all, some of those dresses aren't real dresses. I took the bottom off of one dress and put a top of a different dress and stuffed it in and pinned it and added bows and things just to sort of create something new. It was really fun for me.
Obviously, you've not been on a fashion shoot and watched them find out the girls into those dresses.
I really wish I could wear those dresses, but they're all really tiny, really tiny. So they're not for me, but I had fun with them.
There is this element that runs through, however faint or whatever, of a classical academic training, and it served you well, but you took it and moved it. And you made it your own, where your work, especially some of the figures with the anatomy, it's you can't get much more academic.
Yeah, and that's the training. And actually, that particular piece that you're referring to was created when I was studying the human form, and you were supposed to be very accurate in what you were studying, but. After I finished school, I wanted to break away from all of that. I wanted to break away from tradition and all the voices that were in my head from all the instructors and all the artists of those 4 years that I studied. And I wanted to just try to find my own voice and try to find my own, do my own thing without having, like, I guess, the critic kind of squashing what I felt I really wanted to do. And so my later stuff is very much mixed media, where I'm experimenting with, you know, paper, material. I still have the human form, but it's not real in the sense that you would normally kind of expect. And I just want to play. I wanted to play. I just don't want to be at school anymore. I just want to have fun.
Recess.
Yeah. So it's like, now is the time to really, like, be creative and not worry and just explore and learn and just evolve, you know. So that's what I try to do.
But do you think the common thing about having the education, whether you followed in that strict academic sense, that it gave you the foundation to go anywhere you want?
And definitely.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think definitely.
It gave us a toolbox.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, where do you start? I mean, it's too overwhelming.
Well, it's like music. It's like learning music, a musical instrument. You do have to learn the notes. So we had to learn the notes. There's a set of rules with art, and there's a classical way of learning how to be an artist. And the school is accredited. It's well established. It was a great experience for me, even though it was very challenging, academics and in regards to the techniques of becoming an artist. But I do think I would recommend that way of learning, because then you can find your own voice. I'm at this point exploring just now, after 7 years of school, finding my own voice.
Now you took that same classical training and you've moved someplace entirely different. And do you ever hear in the back of your head some professor going, this is not what I told you?
No, not really. I do hear a few voices, but not anymore. I think for me, I had to go to art school to feel like an artist. I don't know why. There's so many wonderful artists that don't have to do that, but I had to have that thing in my hand saying, I did this. I accomplished this. This is my second college degree. I have an unrelated field college degree. I needed to do this, and it gave me validation to say, okay, I am officially an artist. I wish that wasn't the case. I wish I could have just said, oh, I'm an artist, but I didn't feel that way until I finished school, and I'm just so glad I went. It was great. It was just great, and I met these guys. I mean, I became a whole new person.
Friends.
All new friends. I mean, I still have my old friends, but now I have my friends that know about art. We have this common ground. And if I hadn't gone back to art school, I wouldn't have had that.
I'm in agreement with you, Karen. Total agreement.
Did you feel that gave you someone else to bounce off of ideas or concepts?
Yeah.
I'm one of those self-taught people. Mm-hmm. I work in a vacuum. And the hardest part sometimes is feeling like you're always reinventing the wheel.
Right, right.
What was it like having a camaraderie?
for me, it was really beneficial. I really enjoyed having another set of eyes. I really benefited from the critiques. I was hungry to learn. It was my second career. I did get my bachelor's at Laguna College of Art and Design and my master's, so it was 7 years I spent there. It was challenging, but I definitely also needed the validation. And I see that my work has really progressed. It's my language. Art is my language. I didn't speak English when I came to this country. So I've always been fascinated with my first language and in love with it. And finally, I'm able to pursue it as a career.
It's nice to do what you love. Mm-hmm. And you're doing double work of what you love.
Yes, I'm.
And what's that like, though, too? Remember that these were people that you have a common denominator with as far as educational training. Now they're a part of a gallery. Mm-hmm. And ultimately, you're responsible for what's in the gallery. What's it like to now be wearing both those hats?
Well, I'm just thinking about what you were saying, you know, about working in a vacuum. And previous to actually, like, starting this gallery with Chris, the co-founder, I was working a lot in a vacuum. I was working in my studio, and there wasn't a lot of stimulus, or especially, I mean, artistically. And now I find I'm coming here, and everybody's talking art. I mean, everybody that's here comes to visit, and they talk, and they discuss such a, you know, we're painting here. I get to paint here, you know, while I'm in the gallery, or Karen or Alex are welcome to paint here, and we discuss the medium and what's going on, and it's just really stimulating. It makes me want to paint more, actually, and keeps me on the right track. That's what I feel anyway, and so this is really feeding me creatively, even though there's a lot of the other left brain stuff that I have to do.
Oh, it's kind of a hard thing to do, and
yeah.
It's nice when you're around people who are working in different aspects of it. You work a lot in oil. You're where you...
I mix it all
over the place.
Yeah.
Yeah, I prefer oil.
And how you two handle oil, again, is markedly different. Mm-hmm. They're very, very different. And the subject matters are very different, but when you figure out what's going on, you're both starting in the same spot.
Yeah.
You're starting with canvas and oil.
Yeah.
Well, we start with a basic set of rules, going back to the foundation. We start with an idea. After that, we maybe go to thumbnails. After that, we're thinking about composition. How are we going to get it on the canvas?
Do you both do a lot that are outdoors? So are you doing plein air first? Or?
I hate painting outside. I hate it. I hate it. I love to be outside. I hate painting outside. I have to stay out of the sun. I can't be in the sun. That's a big downside in living in California, painting outside.
No, it's the lizards. I can
do it. Well, the bugs, I don't care about that. I just can't be in the sun. And I don't know. I love being in my studio. It's just being in a studio, you're in a cave. And so it's nice to get out of the cave, but I really don't like painting outside. I don't like people watching me paint. I've heard little tricks, like if you wear earphones, you know, people won't bother you, but
yeah.
I hate it. I just hate it. And I've tried. I've even gone to workshops, and it's still on my list of things to try to embrace, but I really don't like doing that. So I'm just gonna stay in my studio where it's nice and safe.
What was it like to have your first shows? Where you, like, you're bearing your soul. What's it like?
Well, going back to school, the big thing at the end of it was having a thesis and having a theme and being really academic. And I remember all I wanted to do was paint dogs. And I thought, why do I have to paint something that has such a deep kind of hidden meaning? And I had to write a paper about my painting and my painting techniques and why I chose, you know, just to paint dogs, you know. And I thought, you know, I don't really want to, that's not why I'm painting, to be all wordy and academic, you know. I just want to have fun. And so I didn't take it serious. I wanted just to have fun, and I'm not sure I did well, but
I probably felt the same for my bachelor's, But then I started to analyze it. I had to do the thesis for my master's also, which was much more entailed. But I think it's really an exercise. Looking at it now, I think it's an exercise in order to make you have a meaning to every single series you do, to have a clear voice, to know how to express articulately. So each viewer can take something away after a show that is more meaningful. To me, it was helpful. It was helpful. It taught me a way to think. I can't say it was easy. It wasn't easy. It was very challenging. But I see that it was helpful to me.
Did you see this as a way of helping you look at your own work with a critical eye?
I used to get super nervous, like, oh my God, what if they don't like my work? That means I'm really bad. I shouldn't be an artist. I should just stay and be the teacher. But now it's great because I don't really care what people say. If I know that I had fun and I did the best I could and I accomplished what I'm trying to accomplish, I'm okay with that. So that just comes with practice. Mm-hmm. I mean, the more you put yourself out there,
the more you put yourself out there, the other thing that comes with that, other than the praise, which is always nice, and it's like that warm, fuzzy feeling in your belly, it's the one person who's going to sit there and go, you know, and it's, do you hear that, or do you ignore it?
Not anymore. I used to, but I'm not.
When you first heard it, did it influence what you did the next time around?
I think it made me be a very timid painter, and I would change my mind 1,000 times. Like, I'd paint it like that, I'm like, no, I should do it like that. And when I realized I was changing things so much, it just kind of killed the painting. It wasn't as spontaneous. So as soon as I got out of school, my goal was to use a lot more paint and leave it on the canvas. So, you know, okay, if maybe next time I'll try something different, but I think my painting's gotten a lot better because I'm not as afraid. I was afraid of making a mistake. I was afraid of not doing it right. I was afraid nobody would like it. But now I don't care. Plus, the more I go out and see what's in the contemporary art world, really lots of amazing things are being done that are way different than anything I would do. And I appreciate them, and they're great, and it's all great. So there's a place for everything, mm-hmm. really, I think. And it doesn't matter so much. As long as I think I did a good job, I'm happy.
It's you that's up on the wall.
Right.
Yeah.
And it's just, I mean, even with this gallery, Chris and I decided, I mean, we want a real big diversity in artists and mediums, and because anybody that walks in here, somebody loves as far as watercolor or oil, somebody else would rather have a digital kind of painting. And so, I mean, it all depends on who walks through the door and what they like. Everybody's attracted to so many different things. So, it, like you said, it doesn't matter. I mean, anything goes, and whatever image you look at that speaks to you is the one that you're going to buy, you know, or
you have
fall
to
in
live
love with
art. And that's the thing. It's when you put your work out there and someone takes it home, they're living with your piece. You've now injected yourself in their life. There's a kind of...
There's a connection. There's definitely a connection. It's always been important to me who buys my work. Where will they put it?
And they're gonna love it.
How will it be taken care of? What does it mean to them? What are their responses? That has always mattered to me. It's kind of like a little piece of me is with them. And I think that they heard the message that I had with my piece.
Do you want to go and visit them?
Sometimes.
Where is that painting?
Sometimes.
Where are you hanging that painting? Not in the bathroom, I hope.
I have wonderful artwork hanging in my bathroom.
Yeah,
thank you. Just because I put on a wall space every place else, I'm always on the ceiling. I interviewed an artist, and she said the funniest thing to her was she created the piece in the 60s, and she made large sculpture. And she went to buy gates for her new house because the salvage place said, oh, we have gates for you. Well, what's behind the gates? Her piece. And she's like, she looked at it, she goes, I always wondered where it went.
Right, I'm always afraid my stuff's gonna end up at the Salvation Army. After I die, my kids will just dump it in the Salvation Army. So, but you know what, oh well.
Somebody will pick it up and enjoy it.
Yeah, it's okay.
Somebody always loves it. I find it interesting. I love it when people buy art because they want it, mm-hmm. not because it matches the sofa. Right. I mean, that to me is just like, it's like nails on a chalkboard.
I also do really appreciate this gallery for its diversity. Because, you know, you preach diversity, everyone preaches diversity, and then it's not produced in art galleries. In different cities, you have a specific type of art in each gallery. I think it's a real plus to have a diverse group of art because it's sending a different message to the individual, which we all are. So we're fortunate to have the space here.
With being in the gallery all the time and people walking up to pieces that they look at or are attracted to and hearing what they say about them, and especially when it's like one of my pieces and I'm like, they don't know that I did created that it, and they're talking about it,
exciting.
And I'm like, wow, this is kind of fun. I'm being a little fly on the wall, right?
To give them a story and a life.
That's right.
And yours especially, someone must come up to it and just want to just give them a whole life story, give them a pedigree.
Yeah,
and
I just wish they'd buy them. So we'll see. I would defer to Kate about what I'm doing next month. We're trying to change our wall once a month, which was really a great thing about being in this gallery, because I'm responsible for my wall, and I get the chance to experiment mm-hmm. in something new every month. So I haven't taught her. I haven't really taught her about what I'm planning on doing next month, but so I might as well just tell her right now.
Okay.
I think that when you have, I do big paintings, but I think I need to try some small paintings. And when you do small paintings, they look really lonesome unless you have a bunch of them. So I thought I would do a whole wall full, you know, as many as I can of food, little cupcakes and donuts and cookies, and I don't know.
That's
just
fun.
I'm in the mood for that. They don't seem like they really have human names, but I'll decide when
I can see a couple names. If they're red velvet, I have a great name for it. I just ate a whole red velvet cake.
I don't know. I thought it might be fun. I don't know. Just
that is
fun. What's fun is
that
to switch, you know, do a total about face and try something new and
great idea.
Carry it through.
It's fun when you watch artists who are used to working in one scale try to do something mm-hmm. in a different scale. And I've talked to artists who've only done small, and now they're trying to do large, and it's very different.
Yeah, it's different.
Everything changes. You have to go down.
It's really a good exercise.
You have to, because it's the skills you've learned.
Right.
But they have to either be expanded or toned down.
Well, I did a series of paintings for my son's office. He's in a large office in Newport Beach, and they were underwater scenes, and they were huge. I mean, one of them was 6 foot square, which is, for me, pretty big painting. And I thought, oh, this is going to take me forever. That was actually really quick. But just a bigger brush, I didn't worry about tiny little details. I don't know, I have a feeling the small painting is going to be challenging. Because now you have to look at everything when it's that tiny. So we'll see.
And in school, I remember they always said, I'd bring a little small canvas, and the instructor would go, no, you need to paint bigger. You can't learn how to paint or draw on such a tiny canvas. So, and now, after I was through with school, I painted really, really tiny oil painting where I've had to have the big glasses and the little tiny hairs on it, and I'm like, wow, this is so much fun.
I know, it's fun. It's fun to switch it up.
It's exciting that we can do what we want. We have the tools, we have the foundation, we have the training, we have the academics to go with it. And I think it's really a great time for us now. Because we can experiment, we can find our voice, we can do different things. With this gallery, I'm trying to have a theme every month. And so that's giving me the opportunity to explore different parts of the landscape, different areas, different spaces. What's interesting to me is, with my own work, my landscapes maybe look to other people like they're sending a certain message, but I know the real reason I'm exploring them. It's for my own personal reasons, because I'm interested in that space in between. I'm interested in perspective. I'm interested in the organic form rather than the human form, because it just means more to me personally. But then the viewer takes away whatever they choose, and that's also exciting.
It's like going back to your language. I think art is like a language without words and without barriers and without like borders or you know, it doesn't matter where you're from or you know who you are or what language you speak, you can still connect with a piece of artwork no matter what it is, you know, whatever shape or form, or music, or, I mean, anything. You
ultimately, it's a, there's another aspect of art that people don't like to talk about. It's business. You're creating these things in the hopes that someone's going to purchase them and love them. You're not, or you're creating them sometimes just because you want to, but you're presenting them to the public in the hope that someone's going to write a check or, you know, hand over the cash. And how do you deal with the business side of being an artist?
I'm letting her deal with that.
Ah, then we move to the gallery.
That's right. Whatever she does for me is worth everything. I can't do any of that stuff. I just can't. I'm completely useless. I haven't balanced my checkbook since I was in high school. She needs to do all that work for me.
Yeah, well, I'm trying. We're trying. It's like a real balance trying to do both sides of the brain. But it's so funny going back to creating. I mean, when I make a painting, I mean, I'm not thinking about selling it. I'm just thinking about creating it. And it's not when I see somebody looking at my painting, I want to say, oh, I hope they buy it. Even though we own a gallery, it's for some reason it's just that kind of mentality isn't in my head, even with other people's paintings. You know, it's just a pleasant surprise when someone says, I really want to buy this painting.
I have to have it.
I have to have it. And it just feels so good, but it's not something that, you know, as soon as somebody walks in the door, I'm like, oh, I hope they buy
it. Yeah, but that's a luxury because we're not starving.
Right.
The purpose of my work is my own personal expression. And if someone can connect with my expression and my voice and my form of communication, it makes me really happy. And there's a big price tag on that if I'm really happy, because there's not many things in life that you can accomplish that can achieve that. So that's why I continued with the masters, because I do want to teach. And that is important to me. In regards to the gallery and the sales, it's a lot more difficult promoting yourself than it is promoting another business, because I've also done that. So, but I think considering we're with an exceptional group of women, especially the founders, mm-hmm. Kait and Chris, the energy level is so high in this gallery that I think it's incredible. There have been sales, mm-hmm. and I yes. think that's
you're
definitely
creating a voice and a name for yourselves
in this community, which actually does not have another art gallery. So I think yes. that's a huge plus for us that we are the only art gallery in Vista.
What's been the most interesting about talking with the three of you is that you were brave enough to walk away from something safe to do something that is completely unknown, and B, that you were disciplined to actually go through that training mm-hmm. and walk away with something that became your foundation, like you said, your toolbox. Mm-hmm. And that C, you made it your own. And that's what makes you really true artists. And I have to say, I thank you all for sitting with us. And
thank you.
Thank you.
It was fun. Thank you very much.
And everybody should come to Artbeat.
On Main Street.
On Main Street. Artbeat on Main Street.
And everybody's color coordinated, so make sure you call for the color of the day.
Yeah, it was not planned.
Thank you so very much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.